I'm Nick Pettit.
I'm Jason Seifer.
And you're watching the Treehouse Show, your weekly dose of internets where we talk about all things web design, web development, and more.
In this episode, we'll be talking about error messages, the usual dose of responsive design, and our app review is Dash.
Let's check it out. First up is the four H's of writing error messages. This is a really cool post, and let's just get right into it. The four H's are error messages need to be human, helpful, humorous, and humble. So let's just break each one of those down really quick. What do we mean when we say human? Well, this error message from Twitter says error unauthorized. That really doesn't make a lot of sense. It doesn't seem like it was written for people, and actually it doesn't even seem like it would make sense to anyone but a developer.
Makes perfect sense to me.
Well, you're a developer, Jason, so of course it does.
That's on the lower end of the human scale.
The Firefox error message here is, of course, a better example where they say, well, this is embarrassing. I mean, that's something that is conversational, something that people would say in real life. So next up is helpful. Is the error message actually helping the person solve the problem? So if something goes wrong in the application, you know, does it help them make it right? You know, if they entered bad data, are you telling them, hey, you actually needed to enter this other thing?
For example, if passwords didn't match, are you saying the passwords didn't match or couldn't sign you up for the site?
Exactly. That's exactly right. Next up is humorous. So when Last.fm goes down, it's always amusing. It says, holy moly, we just blew a fuse. Need more amps. I mean, you know, it's pretty funny. I really like this example from Gmail as well. When you go ahead and type in your username and you have, you know, too many periods or, you know, a bunch of other different pieces of punctuation, it says, ah, a fan of punctuation, alas, usernames can't have consecutive periods. So pretty nifty. Last one is humble. Basically, it's just saying that you should be apologetic when something goes wrong. Because oftentimes when something goes wrong in a piece of software, the user will often feel like they caused the problem. They're like, oh, geez, I broke it. I must be stupid. I must not know how to use this. When really, it's probably the application.
So you shouldn't say, error, this is probably your fault. That's what you're saying there.
That's pretty much it, Jason. You basically want to apologize to the user and say, oh, we're sorry, something went wrong. We're going to try to fix that as soon as we can.
Oh, that's legit. Cool. Nice bunch of tips there.
Yep.
I thought it was going to be more along, you know, dodgeball tips, but
no.
Whatever.
Nope, not quite.
Next up, we have a project called jhere. This is billed as Maps Made Easy. This is a jQuery plugin that provides a layer of abstraction over on the Here Maps API. So there's a bunch of different things that you can do when working with the Here Maps API. And using this jQuery plugin, you get a very, very easy and simple way of working with what can be a really complicated API. Now, if you take a look at the documentation for jhere, it's very simple and quick to include on your page. And making a map is, I mean, really easy. This is just a couple lines of code. Drop it into your page, and there's different options that you can have as well. Very, very simple to use, and yeah, check that out. jhere uses the Here Maps API, which you don't see a lot of people using, but they do provide really good maps.
Pretty nifty. So next up is a blog post about front-end performance. For those of you that are more advanced, this might be old news, but it's always good to remind ourselves about techniques that provide good front-end performance. So I won't go through all of these tips, but first two talk about resource packaging and using a single host name. So obviously you want to try to reduce the number of resources that you have as much as possible and try to reduce those HTTP requests and serve them all on a single host name. Another tip is to load JavaScript asynchronously. So For example, you can go ahead and load in all of your HTML and CSS and actually display something on the page that the user can actually see. And then in that split second after the page loads, you can go ahead and load in your JavaScript. And you know, they won't really know the difference. It'll appear as though the page loaded very quickly when actually you're still loading in that functionality.
That's something that I think is going to be a bit more useful when you've got the plugins for saying, hey, like us on Facebook, post this on Twitter,
exactly.
You know, load up your page first, then put in the social buttons, because that can slow a page down if you wait for everything to
especially,
load.
Especially, yeah, if you have a lot of social buttons and you just want people to post your stuff all over the internet, then yeah, it's going to take a little while for all those to load in. So it's good to do it asynchronously.
Nice.
Yep.
Next up is going to be our app review.
Let's check it out.
Our app review this week is an app called Dash. Dash is a simple OS X application that is a snippet manager and documentation browser. Now, as we usually say, Dash is not sponsoring the show. This is a paid application. Shame on them. But this is incredibly useful. Here's the Dash website right here. But what it really lets you do is download your different documentation, and then you've got this one window where you have all of your documentation on the left, and then you can search through everything. So let's say you wanted to get the jQuery documentation for the Ajax method. You can just type in .ajax, and it will very, very quickly filter through everything and show you the matching methods in the documentation that it has available. It also has options to Google the method you're looking for or search Stack Overflow. You can also set up a shortcut key to launch Dash from anywhere and search. And then you can even set up your own snippets. You know, if you have a piece of code that you really like, or grab it from the clipboard, create a new snippet, and you can search from that as well. In addition to what it comes built in with, you can always get more documentation. There's a ton of different options for documentation, and then you can also create your own using a specific format that they have on the site. So this is a really awesome application. I just found it recently, and I've been using it basically nonstop. So yeah, check that out. We'll have a link to that in the show notes. You can also get it in the Mac App Store just searching for Dash.
No, I think it's really cool, especially when you're searching for a particular method and you know you have lots of different JavaScript libraries installed. It might be good to go ahead and compare methods. Maybe for the project that you're working on, you don't actually need all the robustness of jQuery, and you can say, oh, well, this smaller library actually has the thing that I need already. And I really like the code snippets feature, too. It's good for organizing your code, especially over you know several years of development.
Yep.
Where you worked on a project like 2 years ago, and you wrote this really cool thing. It's good to remember that that's there and that you can go ahead and use that. So.
Oh, one other really nice feature, all the documentation works offline, so you don't have to be connected to the internet.
Whoa.
Yeah.
That's good for when you're coding on an airplane.
Exactly.
Although a lot of those have Wi-Fi now.
Which is the only time that I'm offline.
Yeah. Next up is FooTable, and FooTable is a jQuery plugin that makes tables look really good at smaller mobile screen sizes.
I thought it was pronounced footable.
It's actually not pronounced Footable. It's FooTable.
Okay.
Believe it or not. So tables are notoriously bad on mobile screens. Basically, when you resize the browser or resize your screen, or you're looking at a mobile screen, it tends to look pretty bad. Tables tend to cause a lot of horizontal scrolling, and there just is so much data that you know you want to display, but it just doesn't fit on the screen. So that's always been a challenge. FooTable aims to solve all of that, and they basically do it by hiding some of the data. So it hides certain columns at different resolutions, which in responsive web design we call breakpoints, and then the rows become expandable to show the data that's hidden. So you see these little plus and minus buttons there. So if a user is looking at a particular piece of data and they want to go ahead and learn more about that, they can click on the little plus button and expand it. So I think it's a pretty elegant solution for handling tables on mobile screens.
That's awesome. Really, really useful.
Yeah, pretty cool.
Next up, we are going to talk about an article on CSS tricks on recreating the BERG cloud buttons using only CSS and HTML. So over on the CSS tricks, also no shame on them. They are a sponsor of Treehouse. Woo. Shame on us for doing the shameless self-promotion. But there's some really cool buttons that they have over on the BERG cloud. And as they say in the article, the BERG cloud buttons are pretty sweet looking. So the article just goes over how to recreate these kind of 3D-ish buttons with backgrounds using just a little tiny bit of markup. And goes through, tells you how to use the CSS box shadow attribute and different classes. And then finally, you can go and see the final version over on a CodePen link. Look at that. Look at that animation.
Wow.
I know. Incredible. It's like we're living in the future.
It's amazing.
Using no images to create these buttons, pure CSS and HTML.
That's awesome.
Yeah, awesome post.
So next up is a blog post over on Design Shack about a GitHub project that I believe is called Focal Point. It allows for intelligent cropping of responsive images. So what does that mean? Well, basically, when you normally resize a responsive design, the images will flex and scale, but sometimes images can get so small that it's hard to really see what is relevant in the image. So instead, this takes the approach of cropping the image. Of course, the problem with that is that if you just kind of crop an image randomly, or well, not randomly, but with the normal focal point, you might cut out what's actually important in the image. It could be over on the right or the left or what have you. This allows you to actually set a focal point for the cropping. So for each one of your images, you basically can take a grid, looks like this, and you would have your normal focal point, which is in the middle, and you can move it up and to the right, for example. Now, the code for this is done in a class name that looks like this. So right 3 and up 3, and that's going to go ahead and change the focal point for when an image is cropped. So on the left here, you can see this original image, and on the right, you can see what it looks like when it's cropped. So it maintains what's actually interesting about the image when it gets cropped and, you know, flexed downward.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Not only is it a great idea for a plugin, you know, CSS and JavaScript, but the site did an amazing explanation of it as well. You know, those illustrations were extremely helpful.
Yeah, it's actually a pretty complicated idea, but, you know, that does make it really easy to understand. Pretty nifty.
Yeah. Next up, we have a project called TinyNav.js. This is a very small piece of JavaScript that is also for responsive design. It'll take a navigation item that you have, say, you know, an unordered list with a bunch of list items, and then on a handheld device or when the screen shrinks to too small a size, it will replace your navigation with a select dropdown with the same attributes as those links. Also, if you are on a current page, it'll actually put that one as the selected attribute. Now, you may be saying to yourself, hey, you know, a lot of these plugins exist out there already. Why would I use this one? Well, the main advantage of TinyNav.js is that it's small. It's only 443 bytes minified and gzipped.
Wow.
I know. That's tiny. That's probably where they got the name, TinyNav.js.
TinyNav. Yes. Yeah.
So I guess that makes sense. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, there's a few options that you can go through, you know, including adding styles and it's you know, pretty easy, pretty simple plugin. So check that one out. That works all the way down to IE6.
Wow.
I know.
That's amazing.
It is.
So Jason, what did we learn today?
I think we learned that hair grows back. We're all happy about that.
Yeah, I'm feeling pretty good. I am at NickRP on Twitter.
And I am at JSeifer. Thanks so much for tuning in to this episode of the Treehouse Show. For show notes or more information on anything that we talked about, check out our YouTube channel at youtube.com/gotreehouse.
And of course, if you'd like to see more videos like this one and learn about web design, web development, mobile development, or starting a business, be sure to check us out at teamtreehouse.com. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next week.
If you'd like to see more advanced videos and tutorials like this one, go to teamtreehouse.com and start learning for free.